Yay! All right, so I'm going to see if I can still find a way to see everybody anyway. Yeah, okay, cool. All right, because I want to be able to see everybody. So yeah, it's not just about questions. I would love to have people share tips and hints and things. This is not so much me saying I'm the awesomest person at WordPress or Laravel. This was a fun experiment for me to do, and so I wanted to share it with some people. And I am fully aware that WordPress is something that a lot of people are really good at and understand really well. And that's not me. So I probably did a lot of things the hard way, things that were maybe not the best decisions to make for the constraints I was trying to work in. So if anyone has any input or feedback or anything, by all means, I'm hoping that this can just kind of grow into something a little better. And in order to do that, I think I need outside input. So definitely use the raise your hand feature to let me know if you want to put some input in, and or write it into chat. Because I know some people might not actually feel comfortable typing, or some people might not feel comfortable talking. So whichever. Yes, Charles.
This is my first time. Curious to know how long you've been around, why you started, and that a question to ask.
No, I think that's a great question. So there's a little bit of information about kind of what I was doing and why, you know, on the actual description, but a little bit more about me. I've been doing professional programming since 1998. I was an old school Perl programmer for a long time, and I've been working primarily in PHP since 2005. There have been other languages in there along the way, but for the most part, it's been a lot of PHP. You know, JavaScript here and there, Java here and there. I've done a bunch of C and C++ projects, and so in that time. I've wanted to be able to do blogging because people do blogging. And, you know, as a PHP developer, one of the things that pops up pretty often is WordPress. I'm going to make an assumption here that I'm thinking it's probably already invalid, that most people here are very familiar with WordPress, being as it's a WordPress meetup.
I'm in sales and marketing. Mm-hmm. I'm not very knowledgeable on WordPress, but know how to function into it per se, but I work with web people.
Awesome.
Yourself and sophisticated just working with.
Yeah.
So I'm here to understand whether or not work with you. I seem to be very in depth type of software people. Mm-hmm. And I say that, and WordPress to me is simple in the marketing sense, but I'm trying to know if really talking to some people that on my level, maybe your meat program is more for larger to medium to large corporations. I work with small businesses, mm-hmm. 1,000 to maybe 3 million in mm-hmm. revenue sales.
Yeah, so coming to WordPress, coming to WordPress early on for me was all about the fact that it was actually relatively simple. It's sort of what WordPress is known for. It has a really quick setup process. The hosting requirements are very liberal. You can use it on extremely old versions of PHP. You could use WordPress in really tightly constrained shared hosting environments. A lot of the shared hosts will actually advertise WordPress because they want to make sure people know they can use WordPress. And this goes all the way up to some of the bigger enterprise installations. If you're using something like WP Engine, I know is one of the big ones, where this one is where you go if you're TechCrunch and you want to, you know, host a lot of people. I don't know if TechCrunch is necessarily here, but I know TechCrunch at one point was definitely WordPress. I think the other option is also WordPress.com, which this is not going to give me the right view because I'm logged in. But there is the commercial aspect of it, in addition to sort of the more traditional, like, open source aspect to it, where anyone can install WordPress for free. You can install it on a $5 DigitalOcean droplet. You could install it pretty much anywhere. I know people have WordPress running on their routers because why not? I don't personally do it, but its footprint is pretty small. Anywhere that PHP can run is where WordPress would live. Now, while I was trying to use WordPress, I didn't like the code base. And so I've grown since then, and I'm a little more nuanced in how I think about those things. But at least back in, you know, the early 2000s, I didn't want to work with WordPress because I didn't want to learn it. It's very powerful, but it's very difficult to use for someone who doesn't think in the way that WordPress wants you to think. On the programming side of things, on the UI side, on the front end, everything is just beautiful and amazing, and for the most part, seems to be pretty user friendly. But as a programmer, I wanted to be able to get in and program things. I wanted to be able to create applications and do things, and trying to do that within the constraint of WordPress seemed really painful. So for, I don't know, maybe four or five times over the last maybe 20 years, 15 years or whatever it is, I've gone full in on WordPress. I've created a WordPress install for somebody. I've created it for a business that I'm working on or something along those lines. But I've never really gotten into it to the point where I'm comfortable using it all the time. And it's never been the first thing that I reach for. Even though it should theoretically be one of my tools because it's within PHP. It is a really great way to edit and manage content. As Charles was saying, a lot of people find it accessible. They can go in and use it. It just works. So over the years, instead of WordPress, I ended up trying to find other solutions. One of them was Posterous, which I really liked Posterous. It was a great way to blog easily. It was almost like a proto Tumblr in a sense. You could spin up a Posterous site. You could post to it from email. You could post to it from bookmarklets. And it was really nice. And I think I probably had four or five different Posterous blogs at one point. And then, of course, as everything awesome, it shut down. So it got announced that it was going to shut down. And eventually, you had to have everything off. And this shutting down April 30th of 2013. So this date's sort of important to me. Because it's after Posterous, I had to do something else. And right around then, Jekyll was starting to be sort of a big thing. This was nice because it was a static website. The hosting requirements were really great because they were minimal. You didn't have to do a whole lot. You just had to have a static web server. There's no typical problems that you might have with like a WordPress install where it can potentially get hacked. There is no making anything, you know, world writable. So this was really cool, but it was in Ruby, and I didn't really know Ruby very well. So I actually, you know, the little thing I had earlier was, you know, not invented here. This is going to be a theme throughout this. I decided to create a PHP version of Jekyll, which was called Sculpin. And Sculpin followed almost the same patterns as Jekyll. It was very much around markdown files that you can edit in any editor you want to, and then you publish it, and it takes the markdown files and generates HTML for you. And so this is kind of where I stuck for a while. And if I don't know if it's actually documented anywhere, but 2013 is pretty much the year I finished Sculpin. And that was largely because I needed to get my Posterous sites. If I wanted them to live on, I needed to actually have them living somewhere. So I needed to build something to maintain some of those older sites. I was really into static sites for a long time. But for a blogging platform, it had a lot of issues that I kind of kept saw coming up. One of them was media handling. If I wanted to add an image, that image has to be added directly to the repository. So for example, this image here hit that actually. Go. Oh, no. Here it is. So this URL is actually hosted in the repository because it has to be. There's no other way to do anything with images if you're doing static sites like this. And that just got really overwhelming for me. I wanted to be able to do some more blogging. I didn't know how to handle the images. Every time I did, you know, I accidentally put a 12 megabyte image in my repository and then later cleaned it up, made it smaller. Well, it's still in the repository. So the best I could do is make other people's experiences better. But then, you know, if you have a sizable blog with a lot of images, eventually that starts to really add up. And the nature of the static sites is that every time you publish the site, it builds the whole thing. So it just continues to get longer and longer to actually publish it. Fortunately, that step only happens on publish. You know, unlike WordPress without cache, every single hit to this page is really cheap. It's really just looking at index.html and a bunch of assets. There's no PHP execution here at all. So it had benefits, but it also had drawbacks. And so what I really wanted to do was have a nicer editor experience. And so I ended up using Medium for a little while because it sort of solved everything for me. It gave me a way to have a custom URL that I could actually own. The editing experience was just amazing. I absolutely loved it. The editor, the way that you could do things. But it sort of lost a little bit of shine for me because it's not mine. You know, it's up on Medium. Unless people are looking specifically for Medium, it wasn't really easy to find my content there. I forgot about it pretty easily because it wasn't on my domains. So yeah, I liked the experience, but I didn't like where it was hosted. I didn't like the fact that it was closer to WordPress.com than WordPress.org because I wanted to own the experience. So coming back to my website, this was the website I started, I think, last year. I rebuilt it as a Laravel application. So rather than a static site, I wanted to actually start building proper pieces into my website that I could do stuff with. So I have a little admin panel just for me that I want to keep adding to. But I also wanted to do some blogging. Like, I definitely wanted to make sure and start writing content. So I did the thing I always did and thought, hey, I can do this really quickly. I can make my own editor. And you know, I always find reasons and ways to experiment with things when I try to build something. And so one of the things I've been looking at was an editor called TipTap. TipTap was based on Vue.js, which I'd been doing a lot of work in Vue.js, and it had a lot of really cool ways to customize things. So you could make things look like Medium in terms of, you can do things that have like inline things, and anyone who's using any awesome editor in WordPress probably has most of this. So it's probably not real impressive for you, but if you're used to only having something, the older generation of rich text editors, they all kind of looked the same. They were all kind of constrained a little bit, but this seemed like it would let me build exactly what I wanted to build. Like, I wanted to have my experience for editing. I want to be able to make it work for me. So I started to work with this, and this is the back end of my website, and this is as far as I got on my editor. And this was probably 6 hours of work, maybe eight, something like that, across many, many nights. And at some point I realized I'm just working on text. You know? And I was trying to replicate stuff that I knew existed elsewhere. And I wasn't actually going to be getting a whole lot of value out of this other than it was, you know, scratching an itch I had to play with TipTap. And I hadn't even gotten to like the fun stuff, like how am I going to handle images? And so that was something that TipTap actually had. It had support for, let's see, where is it? One of these was for dealing with images. And so I wanted to build a pretty nice interface for being able to add content to my blog. And just in general, I wanted to have a place to just store media that I could upload. But I wasn't getting anywhere. And this wasn't really doing a whole lot. And I got frustrated. So I thought, you know what? What if I just use WordPress? I haven't used it in a long time. Maybe I can use it. And I thought, what would be the constraints under which I would accept WordPress in my life? And because I didn't want to have to try to implement any of this stuff in WordPress. I didn't want, well, not this thing in particular, but any of the other things that I have, you know, on my list of stuff to do. I didn't want any of this to have to be built into WordPress because I like Laravel. Laravel's really good at this kind of thing, but it doesn't have, you know, CMS built into it. So I wanted the content to live in my website, not next to it. I didn't want blog.bosimonson.com to look more or less like bosimonson.com, but really all of the blog contents on WordPress. Didn't really want to try to manage a theme or anything like that, because as I'm changing this site, I don't want to have to go in then and change the WordPress site as well. So that sort of led me to do a little bit of exploration. I'd seen a bunch of people talking about Headless Drupal. And I knew that this concept of like a headless CMS was something that people were dabbling with. And I thought this could maybe be part of a solution for me. If I could get the content from the CMS to my application, then I can do whatever I want to with the content and leave the actual editing and the actual management of things like media and whatnot to the thing that does that really well that anybody can use. So I did a quick search for WordPress headless and found all sorts of cool things, and I realized it was something I should play with. So you can do a lot of stuff with it, if you look, there's a lot of information out there for doing headless WordPress using various versions of like the REST API. I think there's an older REST API that isn't there anymore, but it's definitely something that can be done. So I felt confident enough that I could actually try to run with it. So the next step was how much work would it be to integrate directly into Laravel? Because Laravel's ecosystem is usually really good. There's a lot of things in Laravel's ecosystem that are just taken care of for people. It's not quite to the same extent of like WordPress plugins, but almost. Like there are certain libraries that if you use them within the within the Laravel ecosystem, if you use other packages, they all just work together. So it is kind of a tighter knit community than like the broader PHP community is. So I wanted to see what was actually there. And so I found an article on Laravel News talking about WordPress and Laravel. And they'd actually done another post about how they actually did the same thing. So this was posted by Eric Barnes. And the first article, which we'll look at in a second, because this is actually close to what I ended up using, is actually really good. He went into a lot of great detail, and it really was a great starting point for me to try and figure out how to do this. But after doing that, they wanted to make sure that people understood all of the ways, at least at the time, that you could actually integrate with WordPress. And so there's a project called WordPress Corcel. And what Corcel does is it gives you a nice way to get access to posts in the database. So it's using Laravel style classes that access the data within the WordPress database. So rather than going through any WordPress code or going through any WordPress API, it's just talking directly to the posts table. This is really useful if you have the site on the same server that the WordPress host is running on, or if you have the server in a place that can be connected to by both WordPress and the Laravel application. This was kind of a non-starter for me. I didn't really, like, part of the point of hiding WordPress was making sure that it's less accessible to the outside world. and making sure that the database itself was accessible to my application just seemed like it was going to be cause for trouble. So I wanted to avoid that. WordPress to Laravel is a sync, but apparently it only works with WordPress.com. So this sync idea was kind of nice that it actually brought the data in. At least that's what it looks like. And this was sort of the first time, the first time in this project where this requirement of WordPress.com versus WordPress.org sort of became a stumbling block for me. Finding out that, hey, some of these tools are only going to work if you're using the WordPress.com host was not fun, because those solutions, I'm not hosted on WordPress.com. I don't plan to host on WordPress.com. I wanted to host, at least initially, on DigitalOcean Droplet because I'm familiar with that. I wanted it to live there until such time I decided that, yes, I'm going to do this, and then maybe I'll host it somewhere more commercial. But I wasn't going to sign up for a WordPress.com account for a blog that I wasn't even sure was going to work. So there were a couple of these, but by and large, most of them seem to be dealing with database access directly. There is, however, a WP API that I think this is the one that uses the older version of the WordPress API before it was actually built in. And this was actually, I think this actually did use the API. But there was some, it's a Laravel 5 package. And I think, yeah, so this only works with Laravel 5. And by now, Laravel is up to Laravel version 8.1. So this was something I probably could have looked at and maybe brought over. But this was another case of, so there's something there, but I can't use it, which is kind of a bummer. Other methods, I didn't really look into these too much, because what I ended up doing was following the link to the original post that they had done and looked to see exactly how it worked. And so the way that it worked was it used the WordPress API. They used a very simple wrapper that they wrote themselves to make the calls to the WordPress API to get posts with the appropriate filters and the appropriate order by. And then they have a function called sync post that will look for a given post. It'll look for that post locally in the local database to see if that ID exists. If it isn't found, it creates it. And if it is found, it'll update it. So they abstracted this little bit of code so that you didn't really have to care what even changed on the post. All you have to do is just say, go update it, or get the data or create it from this data. The actual create post function, this post class, the database representation of a post in Laravel, is more or less a one-to-one map with what is in the WordPress database, or at least what can come off of the WordPress API. So there's user ID is actually getting from the embedded author. So this was a case where you'd have to make sure and include the author. The WordPress API itself has the ability to add embeds. So if there's one or more authors, you can actually add those. Or it can actually be included in the post response if you ask for it. Same thing for things like the taxonomies. So there's embedded terms, but only if you actually ask for them. So here's where it's syncing tags. So this is...
Charles, go ahead.
Yep.
Yeah, I'm going to have to leave right now, but I'll catch you the next time. I got some basic information about your organization. I'm going to have to leave right now.
I have another appointment.
Thank you very much, and I'll be back, though.
Thanks, Charles. Have a good rest of your day.
Thank you.
Bye.
Bye. This function's job is to take the raw data from the API from WordPress and create a copy of that inside the Laravel application. There's a bunch of other stuff that we won't go into about getting the featured image because we have to be able to get that down to basically just a URL because we want to just store the URL. We don't need the rest of the information. Category information, syncing the posts. This is another case of using a community library called Cartalyst. So this was something that makes it easy to add tag-like functionality to a Laravel model. So they're using that here. I don't think they're, since category was intended to be just like a single category, instead of a potentially a collection of categories, it was a little different, and it actually brought in additional information than just the name. So it wasn't just the post name, or wasn't just the name of the taxonomy. It's actually storing also the WordPress ID for the category, the name, the slug. So that's in case you're doing something more complex with categories where you actually want to keep that metadata around. And then the other job was just trying to actually write an artisan command. This is like a command line call that you can do to sort of extend your Laravel application. So this would be making it so that you can run a command called import that you could write PHP artisan import, and it would just go and import everything for you. How many people are using the WP CLI for anything? Okay, so it's sort of like that, where I don't know how easy that is to extend, but it's that same kind of functionality. Artisan is Laravel's way to provide a bunch of tools on the command line to manage your install. So this sort of gave me a really good template for what I wanted to do. I was able to sort of visualize this flow of data from WordPress into my database so that I could then display the information. So the next step was actually installing my blog. And so I have it in a Forge managed DigitalOcean droplet. Forge is a Laravel community inspired tool that manages VPS systems for you. So they made it really easy for me to spin up a new DigitalOcean host and then actually install WordPress on it. So all of this content you see here is exactly the same content that you see if you go to my articles. So this is actually the source of that information. And if we go into the backend, I'll give you an idea of the things that the other pieces that I wanted to sort of use to make this whole process a little nicer. I didn't want to have to run a command anytime I updated a post. That was part of what this solution talked about doing here. It was creating the import command and then telling it to run every minute. That seemed like overkill to me because I don't really feel like I'm going to be doing a lot of blogging. not enough for that to matter. But I also like things to happen quickly. So if I make a change, I like to make sure it's reflected elsewhere as soon as possible. So I decided to look for a webhook solution. I assumed it would be easy for WordPress to send webhooks. Trying to do it on my own, that did not seem nearly nice at all. And I wanted to try and avoid problems I've had in the past of getting too many plugins in play. So the actual list of plugins I have right now is more than I would like, probably. The ones that I added specifically for this project were WP Webhooks, WP Offload Media, and WP OAuth Server. So the other ones here were just because I was playing around with a couple of things, or they were just had to be there. Things like a Kismet, we can talk about that later, but we don't really need that because nobody's going to be posting comments. They can't. I mean, they could if they find this random URL and find a way to log in as me or something. So I've disabled registration and all those things, but I'm not a WordPress security expert, so I don't know how easy that would be for them. But these were the main things. So the first one we're going to look at is WP Webhooks. And this one was actually not too bad. the information was a little sketchy on what you need to do. But essentially, you're able to either receive data, so it actually can add a webhook to receive data, or you can send webhooks when certain things happen. So for me, I wanted to send data. I wanted to notify my websites anytime a post was created, updated, deleted, or crashed. And I created a little hook named for each of these. So this is actually two different blogs, which we'll talk about in a minute. But one goes to Bo Simonson webhooks blog post created. And if you look at the settings, the first thing that I didn't understand was anytime I did something, it would actually send multiple webhooks. Every time I created something, every time I updated something. And apparently there's trigger from back end only. So for some reason, if I didn't have that clicked, then it was actually triggering it multiple times. So that was a thing that I didn't understand. It looked like every post submitted through the front end is ignored. I have no idea what the front end is versus the back end in this case. I'm guessing JavaScript, like if there's something JavaScript-y happening, that it would trigger that something was updated both in PHP and on the JavaScript side. But I don't know. I wasn't able to dig into it and figure it out. But these were the types of things that I ran into working with WordPress that I just had no clue. And so I don't know if this kind of thing is easier for people who are more familiar with WordPress plugins, but that was a little tricky to try and figure that out. So the WordPress webhooks was a way to notify my actual application anytime something changed. So as we know, when we try things live, it doesn't work. So I'm going to see if I can change something and just see if it happens immediately. So we're going to go to posts. This one called, it's draft. And so I'm going to say, hope works. And so if I save draft, in theory, this should trigger a webhook that should then be picked up here, and this article should get a new title. Doesn't work. I'm not going to debug why. but that's sort of how it's supposed to be. There we go. So it got it. So that's the experience that I was looking for. I wanted to make sure that as I made changes on WordPress, I just wanted it to come over, but I also didn't want to be polling the database, all of the articles every time some, you know, timer went off or whatever. So it's not foolproof. If something happens for that particular request, this won't be transferred and it won't try again or anything like that. So it's not perfect yet, but it was a good start to sort of do proof of concept that this idea could work. One of the other things that I wanted to do, or one of my other constraints that I put on myself, was I wanted to do some fun stuff with media, but I didn't really want to advertise the fact that everything was behind WordPress. I also wanted to make sure that it wasn't actually writing content to a host somewhere where I had to pay attention to disk space or anything like that. So what I did was I researched options for trying to move the media library off. And so I ended up on WP Offload Media. And this one actually works with DigitalOcean Spaces. And so it pushes everything up to DigitalOcean Spaces. And then I configured the bucket to have a secure CNAME. So I think it was this rewrite media URLs and custom CNAME or custom domain CNAME. So blogassets.bosimonson.com will actually point to the information where it's supposed to be. So if I look at, say, this image here, and I open up in a new tab, we can see it's blogassets.bosimonson.com. So it still looks like a WordPress URL if you're used to WordPress URLs, but it doesn't point to blog.bosimonson.whisperinghaze.dflydev.com/media/whatever. That was kind of what I wanted to avoid. It's still on a different domain. It still makes sense because if you put stuff on a CDN, Sure, like a lot of people do that. So this felt really good to me. So I was pretty happy with that. It took a little while to sort of figure out exactly how to work all of these pieces together. But I felt pretty good about this. And now the nice thing is if I want to go look at my media, I haven't done a whole lot with it yet, but this has solved my long running problem of hosting images in places. I can, if I wanted to, I could probably set up a WordPress instance just for images and media that I can use. And now my repositories don't have to have images in them anymore, even if they don't necessarily integrate with WordPress themselves. That's kind of what I was hoping to do with this. Hiding WordPress, I guess, wasn't super important, but I just didn't want to advertise to the world that this URL existed. That kind of opens it up. It's a little bit security through obscurity, because I know it's still there, and it's probably not super difficult to actually find it. I just wanted this to be its own thing. I didn't want to care for this server a whole lot beyond just making sure WordPress is updated. I didn't want to have to worry about uptime on this server or anything. It really just needed to be in the background. So I think it satisfied that requirement really nicely. And the last part was WP OAuth server. So the WordPress REST API is a little weird because apparently it's not complete and not a lot of people are using it, yet all of the WordPress tools are now built on top of it. So I don't really understand how that works. I get the feeling that maybe Automattic does just enough to get their stuff working and then that's all they care about. But I could be totally misunderstanding that. But the idea that the authentication stuff, let's see, there's key concepts. I think there was anything in here actually about authentication. Why is authentication not working? So it doesn't really talk about how it is supposed to work, but apparently WordPress has a lot of tools built in to support various types of authentication, not just for APIs, but just in general. And so a bunch of the plugins that I ended up looking at weren't necessarily specifically for the REST API. They were for providing alternative ways to give access to WordPress using different mechanisms. So the one that I ended up with was WP OAuth Server Pro. I don't remember why I had to get the Pro version of this. But what this gives you, I remember now. What this gives you is the ability to act as a, I always get the OAuth roles wrong, gives you the ability to have WordPress act as a provider, I think, where people can log in to your WordPress site using credentials provided to them via the OAuth workflow. So if we look at OAuth server, I can see the clients. So this is my website, so I have a client ID. So this is actually going to be my client in this case is actually going to be my website. It has a client ID. I'm not going to show you. If I click into here, it's actually going to show you my secret because it doesn't bother to hide that, which is really annoying. But if I create a new client, it gives you a better idea. So I can say, let's do WordPress meetup. Redirect URI. This would be, I'm not going to put one there actually. Client credentials assigned. So you can say if you authenticate with this new client, we're going to give you access to either no user or we're going to say Bo. So Bo is what I actually ended up doing. You can choose the flows. So if you know anything about OAuth, there's different flows that you can set up. Implicit is sort of what you would do for like a JavaScript application where you don't actually get the client ID. User credentials, client credentials, and whether or not you want a refresh token. So these are all the things that you can actually do with this. And then the one that I picked, I believe, was, I think I used client credentials. Because client credentials let me pass the generated client ID and the generated client secret And then I get to be using the site as Bo, which is what I was looking for in this particular case. Versus doing some of the more complicated things like making me log in as Bo and getting an authorization code that would be changing every time they get a refresh code or whatever. This was the simplest way, which isn't true. The actual simplest way was to send my actual username and password, base64 encoded, or whatever it is for HT, standard HT auth or HV auth. I just didn't want to do that. So this was one step above where if these client credentials get stolen, I can refresh them or turn them off. I don't have to change my password or anything like that. So, you know, this was, you know, I mentioned not invented here earlier. There's a lot of this stuff that I didn't need to do to get this to work. I could have sent my password. I could have sent my username. I could have just set a cron job to check every 10 minutes or whatever. Kind of gives you an idea of where my mindset is on some of these things. But yeah, so the OAuth stuff, like if you were to do something like this with a different, like a different backend other than Laravel or even if you did it in Laravel, you could do it completely differently because there's nothing, like there's not only one way to do this. But if you are a WordPress developer and understand the authentication tools on the backend, it's entirely possible that you'd be able to create something a little simpler than this that would work specifically for your case. Like maybe you just want to generate a token on the server and associate that token with a specific user in your WordPress with a WordPress plugin where you just say, hey, this token is Bo. That probably would have been a lot easier. And if I actually knew more about how to do things like that with WordPress, I totally would have done that. Likewise, with the webhooks, all of this stuff was really complicated. Like trying to set each one of these up. If I knew the hooks better for WordPress, I would have just hard coded the URLs in some plugin somewhere, or just had like a text field here that said, "Here's the webhook, go do it." but yeah, so I had to do plugins, but I know that a lot of WordPress people are comfortable with plugins anyway, so I guess it's not a big deal. But this is sort of what my environment looked like on the back end. The things that I did on the actual PHP side of things are inside Laravel were a little different. So let me see if I can, well, actually first I'm going to do, kind of give you a better idea. So this is my control panel for my actual website. And this shows all of the content that actually lives in my server right now that has been sent over from WordPress. But it's showing it locally so that I can actually jump into things. So I had to solve for certain issues, like this hello world has a, if you can see down in the bottom, you can see the URLs. So it actually has slugs. I think one of these doesn't. Yeah, so this one doesn't have a slug yet. So I needed to be able to find a way to preview that on my site, even though it's not a, it doesn't have a slug. So this one here, I have an extra route that I added that uses a post ID. And so it's able to just use that. But so there were little things like that I wanted to sort of figure out. Over here, actually this makes it more obvious. Anywhere that says view, it has a slug. Anywhere that says preview, it's actually previewing. So I do really like WordPress's ability to actually properly preview things before you save them, or before you actually publish them. But I wasn't able to sort of, I think they're draft posts, some sort of post type. Oh, revision posts. I think it's the revision type that I probably could have done something with, but that was just going to be a lot of work. So I haven't touched that yet. The other thing is I wanted to make it easy to edit these, because if I'm working primarily on my website, I wanted to be able to edit them. So I'm just hacking the URL to make it easy to just jump directly to the page in WordPress. So the Laravel application needs to be aware of the WordPress actual actual host names so that it can do things like this, like generate stuff. And then just quick links to WordPress admin, getting listing of the posts, or creating new articles. So if I just want to be able to do things really easily, I can do these here. That's kind of the user side of the Laravel code. And let's see, let's do pull up PHP Storm real quick. They give you an idea of kind of where this went. So my original install was on Bo Simonson. And one of the things I really wanted to do was have better support for, not better support, but I wanted to try and support potentially multiple blogs. So a WordPress post, if I look at the migrations for WordPress post, it actually has a blog column. So I wanted to be able to say that, for example, this content came from bosimonson.com versus dflydev.com. I don't know how many people are doing those sorts of things right now where you're received, like, it could really just be like an Atom feed potentially as well. But this would be another way to say, like, if I have related content from my personal page, but it's on my work site, I want to be able to list those. Or if I'm blogging about things that are relevant to one of my services on my work site, I want to be able to say, oh, hey, by the way, Bo's written about these things. And so that they're, even if I don't show the content in both places, at least if I'm aware of it and can say, here are the titles and here are the tags, and associate them that way. But my first pass at this didn't really work very well, because it didn't take into account the possibility of having multiple blogs. So if I look at WordPress.php, there wasn't really a lot of room here to actually support multiple blogs, because I just wanted to get it done. So it wasn't until the second pass that I actually got a bunch of things working a little better. But before I show that, let's look at route service provider. The actual routes for these are relatively straightforward as far as Laravel routes are concerned. The articles list, so this is basically slash articles for any GET request. Looks for WordPress post. This is the WordPress post model. Any of them that are published, get the newest first, and then get them, and then pass in articles. So that's all that you have to do in order to be able to see the article list. For a preview, you're looking for a specific ID. So you have blog post, or the view is blog post, and then we're just getting that specific ID. So if I ask for, should be able to ask for blog post and then like blue. It should fail, and it's going to give me a 500 server error because it doesn't know what to do with that. It's trying, but it doesn't really know. Probably the better thing there would be to give me a 404, so there's a little bit of room there. But that's what happens. WordPress find is trying to find it, and if it can't find it, it's basically somewhere is calling post, or calling a method on post, but post is null, which is why we get a 500. Otherwise, we get post by slug. So this is the last route defined, which means it's going to be the fallback route. So if nothing is found up to that point, it looks to see if the entire URL is a slug. If that is a slug on a post, and if it is, it uses that as the post. So that's why we can do hello world. Because that's actually finding a post with that slug, which is probably pretty similar to how some of WordPress's core routing works. But, you know, I feel like there should be a better way to handle this kind of routing in Laravel. I know that Symfony CMF router is something that Symfony CMF uses this, and also I think Drupal might use part of this in their in the newest Drupal. But this sort of thing where you have routes that don't maybe necessarily conform to standard REST structures and things that are more human readable as opposed to computer friendly. There should be better ways to do this sort of thing, but there isn't right now. So I'm going to switch over to eFly Dev real quick. And it's slightly different in that rewriting it, I was able to think a little bit more about things. So instead of creating a separate WordPress page, I actually created Headless WordPress. Here we go. So I realized that some more things needed to be figured. So the middleware that's going to be used, which is something that is a Laravel specific thing that may not make sense for a lot of people. The prefix for the routing. So this would be where does the webhook live? So post create, post updated, post deleted, those sorts of things. What is the URL prefix leading up to that? And then I have blogs. And so now I have named blogs that each can have their own credentials. The default is default. But I actually have two different blogs in here. So I have Bo Simonson, dFly Dev. They both have their own client ID and a separate secret that is configured. So this was one thing. And then the actual code lives in packages. And so database, the migrations. The migration is more or less exactly what it was before. From my first pass at it, except that it creates both posts and authors at the same time. The routing is a little different, so it doesn't really have the same fallback necessarily. So I wanted to make sure that this is the routing for the webhooks, that is. I wanted to be able to specify the blog in the webhook. Otherwise, there wasn't a way to actually notify, but you wouldn't know which blog post was updated for or created for. So this gives you that chance. Or if you're just doing a default, you just do post created, post updated, post trash, post deleted. Inside here, there's a bunch of jobs and actions that live in here. So like change WordPress post is what this is calling. And then this sort of goes into the actual work of finding the information, which looking at which blog it is. So here we're saying if it's a revision, we ignore them because we don't want revisions. So I'm not going to go into too much more detail on this, but this is sort of where the things come in. This was an attempt to actually extract the code that I did for the first website into a separate package just for the other website, and it does actually work a lot better. So I think this will be the last thing I'll share because I know we're at time here. It does actually support both websites. So if I look at WordPress posts, we can see that the dflydev.com site actually has a page from dflydev and a post from dFly Dev, and it has a post from Bo Simonson. And I think this is the one we just did. So that didn't just go to the dflydev.com site, that or didn't just go to bosimonson.com, it actually ended up on dflydev.com as well. But it doesn't actually show up there because I guess that's the other one that's interesting is our controller for articles. Yeah, so instead of just asking for the slug now, I'm specifically saying where blog is dFly Dev. So I'm able to say that I'm able to consume posts and content from many blogs, but I have a lot of flexibility on what I actually present. So in this case, you know, where blog, dfly dev, look for the slug, first or fail. So here I fixed that. So first or fail is actually going to give us a 404. Whereas before, when I just said find, it wasn't going to do that. And articles is doing the same thing. Articles where the blog is dfly dev, published, not pages, newest first. So that was the other thing that the new code handles better. It actually handles both posts and pages. Whereas the first pass that I did it, it was just doing posts. But now I wanted to make sure that we could actually do pages as well. So this sort of shows all the way from like conception of the project to sort of the inspiration that led me there. And then this gives you the data view, the raw data view of what we actually get to see when all of this stuff gets worked in. So I didn't end up getting a lot of feedback or questions or comments along the way. I don't know if we have time for more questions if we're done now.
Yeah, I don't have a meeting until 3:30, so
okay.
I can give you 15 minutes.
Okay.
Does anyone have any questions or want to chat about what you saw, what you think you saw, what you'd like to see?
What I should have done differently.
No. Of the faces that are moving, nobody's raising their hand. But.
Okay, awesome. Oh, cool. Thanks.
Bob and Nate say it was awesome, and thanks for.
Yeah, thanks for that. Thanks Nate, and thanks, Bob.
It's not reverse engineering. It's just that you had a thing that you wanted to do.
Yep.
And you did it with what you knew. And, you know, instead of what I would do is read through manual after manual and scare myself out of even starting. So kudos to you.
Yeah, right on. Yeah, the desire to figure out how things work is great. But sometimes it really helps to have expert knowledge, right? Like, you know, people who actually use WordPress would be awesome to be able to say, hey, how should I do this? But yeah, it was definitely a lot of fun, and trying to poke around and figure out how things work is what I love doing.
Eric, a question?
Sure.
Yeah, I'm a brand new user to WordPress and stuff like that. And actually, I inherited a website with WordPress on it. And got basically two versions back where the newer versions have blocks and stuff like that. In order to make things work the way I wanted it to work, I had to kind of tables and things like that in order to get the columns to work the way I want them to work, like that. My question is, how important is it? I've got the website working now as the customer wants it and as I want it. Is it that important to update the WordPress just because it's a better editor and better structure with blocks instead of what I was using?
I'll take this one. Okay. So it's important to keep WordPress up to date so that it is secure.
Right. Well, I have somebody who does that.
Okay.
Updates it, but the thing is that we haven't used the updates, you know, as such.
Oh, gotcha. You don't need to use the Gutenberg block editor if that's not the.
I've got it working fine now, and so it's not like, you know, I got other things to do. That kind of stuff. It's not a major website to me. So I'm just an electrical engineer that, you know, retired and inherited.
And now you're a web developer.
Webmasters for like 5 or 6 webmasters with all different softwares, including Wild Apricot to straight HTML and WordPress. And thank God I have my co webmaster is a master at, he's like the information vice president for public television. So it's like, this guy is good. And he says he'll do all the updates and make sure all that's fine. If I do all the fancy stuff and
make it look good and do whatever they want to say. Sure, I'll do that. But
yeah.
I got working, and then so I went to a different Gainesville WordPress yesterday, and they were saying, well, why don't you just go to the block stuff? And I'm like, because it works better on mobile. And I found out that mobile, that everything works fine on the mobile except for have one drop in that's a meta slider that does picture slides, and I've got it working fine, but it just doesn't want to, there's not enough room on the mobile to see it, anything on it. So I was thinking of just dawned on me what I could do is just simply put a link just below it, and all people want to see that it up in its own window, and it should be big. Not fancy, but it's doable. And I don't want to create a lot of work. I don't mind the work. I just don't want to break something and then have to find figure out how to fix it.
We recommend using a staging environment so that you're not breaking changes on a live site. So if you've got the flexibility on your host to do that, then.
But we got the host has a dashboard.
Eric Anderson, did you have a?
Yeah, I was just curious about when you started working with Laravel, what did you find to be sort of a good project to start with? I know blog, probably a good one, having like grub operations. Just curious what would be a good idea to start with?
So I know blogging is a typical good place to start for things because it gives you a good feel, but I think what most of the stuff that I've been doing lately have been like little websites that have some sort of interesting API behind them. Like, I don't find CRUD to be terribly interesting because it ends up with a lot of boilerplate. At least I feel like there's a lot of boilerplate in it. So if there's anything that you can do to maybe pick something that you could automate if you had access to an API. So like a bunch of the stuff that I've been doing with my live streaming stuff has all been around automation and API work. And, you know, if you had a little control panel that you could go to and has a button on it that does something that you do every day, I think that would be a good, that could be a good place to try and figure out how to use Laravel and sort of see what its functionality is. I don't know if my screen is still shared.
No, it is.
Or let's see here. So like, I can find a really good example. So like the things that I'm doing on this site is I'm integrating with Feedbin. I'm integrating with the Todoist API to add tasks as things come into if I star something on Feedbin, I add it as a lead to Pipedrive. And as I add activities to people, organizations, or leads in Pipedrive, I automatically add tasks to Todoist. So, I mean, in a sense, if you've ever worked with like If This Then That or Zapier, a lot of that stuff that you can actually do yourself with a little Laravel API. I think I showed some of my routes here. These are like a bunch of these routes are really simple. Like while I'm doing some weird things here to make like standard routes, but if we look at say OAuth redirect for Stream Deck. So this was OAuth handler that I'm trying to build. I get the client ID, the client secret. I redirect if I need to. Otherwise, I get the information. Send a post, get a response. I mean, so like these are the types of things that I have no idea how you would do this in WordPress, but within something like Laravel or Symfony or can't remember the new Zen framework one. Is it Mezio? Something along those lines. Or even like SlimPHP. You know, you have a handler that takes an HTTP request and does something with it. And there's no other cruft. There's nothing else around it. So if you have something like this in your life that you could use, I would say this is probably a more interesting thing to play with and try to figure out what to do with it. Kind of a weird roundabout sort of question, but I would be so bored trying to learn a blog. If I'm a WordPress developer, I feel like it would be boring to try to figure out how to write a blog in Laravel. But if you did want to do something like that, there are, I think, for what it's called, Laravel blog. Remember, there is actually a blogging framework, or like a drop-in blog for, oh, I can't remember what it is now. My bad. But there are a couple of those that you can just drop into. Nate just said that Laracast is also good for learning in general. So that is actually a really good reference to point out if someone's looking at trying to do some more things with Laravel or just doing things outside of WordPress. This is definitely a good place to try out.
Cool. Thanks.
Yep.
And just another reminder, if y'all want to check out or have someone's ear outside of the meetup, medicinewp.com has a